So this is a talk with a somewhat vague title. It's based on joint work with my co-authors here, Michał and Marcin, who are here, and Socket and Marek, who are not. Before I proceed with the talk, I'd like to advertise a book on parameterized algorithms about to be published by Springer sometime early this year, hopefully. So we have tried to make the book so that you both can read up on all the cool advanced techniques and can teach a graduate course based on it. So it's nice, right? Let me tell it myself. I'm announcing the book before my talk so that you won't judge the quality of the book based on the quality of the talk. So what's this talk about? It's about tree decompositions. I'm sure that almost all of you already know the definition, but even though you do, don't fall completely asleep during this slide, because there are some notions that you might have missed. So what is a tree? Oh, actually, don't fall asleep during the next slide. A tree decomposition is a pair. So the tree decomposition of a graph is a pair, T and chi, where chi is a function that maps vertices of the tree to sets of vertices of the graph, so that the following two conditions are satisfied. For every vertex of the graph, if I look at the set of vertices of the tree who map to a set containing that vertex U, then that is a connected non-empty subtree of my decomposition tree. The second, if I have a tree and a function that takes vertices of the tree to sets of vertices in the graph, then saying for every vertex in the graph, which vertices in the tree map to sets that contain me, this is a natural notion of the inverse function. So one way you can say is, for every vertex in U, the inverse of chi is a non-empty connected subtree of T. And the second property is that for every edge of G, there should be some vertex in the tree so that chi of that vertex contains both endpoints of the edge. All right, this is a decomposition. This is a definition that isn't too easy to parse on first go, so let's look at the picture. Suppose I have a graph G, and I want to give you a tree decomposition of it. So here is a tree decomposition. It's a tree, and for every vertex of the tree, I have labeled the value of chi of that vertex, which is a set of vertices in the graph. If you look at the ABC course, so the left vertex corresponds to this set, the next one corresponds to this one, and CDE is here. You can see how you basically decompose the graph into small pieces that are connected to each other in a tree-like fashion. So some concepts from tree decompositions. The sets that are attached to every vertex of the tree are called bags. The width of the decomposition is the size of the largest bag minus one. Now the one that you might not have heard are, what are the adhesions of a tree decomposition? So the adhesions of a tree decomposition is the following. You look at an edge of the tree decomposition, and then you look at the two bags that are the endpoint of that edge, and you take the intersection of those two bags. So if I'm looking at the edge between BCD and CDE in the tree, then I take the intersection of those two, and then C, D, this is a vertex set in my graph G, that's an adhesion of the tree decomposition. each edge of the tree defines one adhesion. And I guess the reason these guys are called adhesion is that you can see that the piece A, B, C, D, and the rest are glued together at C, D, right? So hence the name adhesions. One more concept that we're going to be using, and that's the concept of torsos. So for every bag of the tree decomposition, there is a torso. If I look at the bag, for example, so what is a torso? You take the graph G induced by the vertex set in the bag, but then you make all of the adhesions of that bag into cliques. So for example, if I'm looking at the bag BCD, let me look at G induced by BCD. There are two adhesions at BCD, right? It's the AB one, and then there is the CD one, so let's add those two edges. So this is a torso of the decomposition. All right? Okay. So the reason you probably have seen tree decompositions already is because probably you have seen tree width. What is tree width? Well, if I take the minimum over all tree decompositions of the graph, of the width of that decomposition, that is the tree width of the graph. So it captures how tree-like the graph is, because trees have tree width 1, and if the graph is sort of tree-like, then you can assume that the tree width will be a small constant, let's say 5 or 10. Now, tree width is pretty cool, right? If you know that the tree width of your graph is at most 10, you can do all sorts of things with it, both structurally and algorithmically, right? Kressel's theorem states that anything you can formulate in monadic second-order logic, which is pretty much anything, then you can solve it in linear time on graphs of constant tree width. However, the sad fact of life is that most graphs have large tree width. And then you can ask yourself, well, we've spent all this time setting up the notation for tree decompositions and these notions around it, and it turns out that it's only useful for a relatively small subset of graphs. It's a very cool subset of graphs, but a relatively small one nonetheless. So then the question is, well, are these notions useful beyond bounded tree widths? And the answer is, of course, yes, very much so. In fact, many of the classical graph decomposition theorems that date back from from early, like 20th century until some of the very recent ones are quite handily stated in terms of tree decompositions. Many of the original ones aren't stated in terms of tree decompositions, but you can quite handily restate them in terms of. So I'm going to play this game for a little bit before shifting gears for this talk. So here is one simple example. So let's say that a graph is k-connected. If I cannot remove less than k vertices and make the graph disconnected. So one connected graphs are exactly the connected graphs, and the two connected graphs are the ones so that I cannot remove a single vertex and make the graph disconnected. Clearly, not all graphs are two connected. Not all connected ones are either, but there is something called block trees, which basically states that, so it's a tree decomposition with adhesions of size 1, so all of the cuts in the tree decomposition have size 1, and every bag is two connected. When I say that every bag is two connected, it means that the graph induced by that bag is two connected. Okay. Now you can do the same for 3, right? And this is known under different names. It's either known as TUTS decomposition into 3 connected components, or SPQR trees. Originally, this was studied in like 37, I think. And this is that every graph has a decomposition with adhesions of size at most 2, now so that every torso is 3 connected. So you take the graph, induced by a particular bag, but you make all of the adhesions into cliques, right? And then the torso will be three connected, all right? So then there is the question, what's the point of this, right? Why are we decomposing a graph into its three connected components or something like this? Well, if you have a tree decomposition of a graph with small adhesions, then the intuition is pretty much like this, that if you are able to solve your problem, whatever your problem is, on the torsos, then with some technical effort, you will be able to solve it on the entire graph. So, and this is an idea that goes through pretty much all algorithms for tree decompositions. So here is a simple example. Let's look at the graph isomorphism problem. Give you as input two graphs, G1, G2, on n vertices. And I ask you, well, are these two graphs actually the same graph? It's just that I labeled the vertices differently. It's neither known to be in polynomial time nor NP-complete. It's actually perfectly consistent with our knowledge that tomorrow someone comes with a polynomial time algorithm for this problem. However, if someone gives us an NP-completeness proof, that would be the great surprise. Then the polynomial hierarchy will collapse. However, this is a problem that is solved very well in practice. It runs greatly, but we don't know whether it's polynomial time or not. However, if the two graphs are planar, you can actually test isomorphism in polynomial time. How? Okay, let's apply the decomposition into three connected torsos to reduce the problem to three connected graphs. I'm not going to tell you exactly how this is done, but believe me when I say that if you are able to solve planar isomorphism for three connected graphs, then you can also do it for all planar graphs, and the trick you use is the tree decomposition, all right? So, what do we know about three connected planar graphs? Well, they have a unique embedding into the plane, right? So then to test whether two plane graphs are isomorphic or planar graphs, then all you need to do is you need to draw them, and then you need to check whether the two drawings are the same up to rotation and taking one face and wrapping it out, right? So these two graphs happen to be the same. All right. And it's relatively easy to check this in polynomial. Another theorem that crucially relies on tree decompositions is the graph minors structural decomposition. That says something like this, right? If I fix a graph H, say the clique on 10 vertices, and look at the class of graphs that exclude H as a minor, then there will always exist a tree decomposition of G, so for any graph G in this class, there will always exist a tree decomposition with adhesions size at most H, so at most 10 in this case, right? So that the torsos, so every torso is almost embeddable. Now, what is almost embeddable in a surface of genus 10 squared means? Well, you can draw it on a surface with 100 holes, if you first remove some constant number of vertices and do some magic inside some of the faces that we're going to call vortices, but I'm not going to really go into the details of that. This has been lifted to topological minors by Groh and Marx that says that every graph that excludes H as a topological minor has a tree decomposition where every torso is either nearly embeddable or has almost bounded degree. So what does almost bounded degree mean? It means that you can remove a constant number of vertices so that after you remove those vertices, the graph has constant degree. So think of it as somewhere between bounded degree and bounded degeneracy. You can use this decomposition to solve graph isomorphism on topological minor free graphs in polynomial time, for every fixed excluded topological minor. The way this is done is pretty much the same as what we did for planar graphs, just much more complicated, right? It means that, okay, you can reduce graph isomorphism for the general class to the how the torsos look like, right? So you need to be able to do isomorphism on almost bounded degree graphs and nearly embeddable graphs. For nearly embeddable graphs, there is an old algorithm, and for bounded degree graphs, there is also a classical algorithm by and Lux. Right? So you combine those two, you need to do it cleverly, and then you get that. So here's a picture, shamelessly stolen from Felix Riedel, about how the different classes of graphs, minor free, topological minor free, and so on, look like. Say the planar graphs, the bounded genus, you introduce some holes, but the H-minor-free and the topological minor-free graphs, when people think about it, you really think about them in terms of tree decompositions, and that you take some nice-looking graphs and you glue them together along small adhesions. Okay, so this was the survey kind of the start point of this talk and of our work, and now let's ask sort of a very ambitious, hopeless dream kind of question. If I give you a graph G and an integer K, is it possible to, obliviously to what you're trying to do, compute the best tree decomposition with adhesions of size at most K? So what do we mean by the best? Well, let's restrict ourselves to properties of the torsos. So we're not going to ask ourselves like how things glue together or anything, just the properties of the torsos. And let's restrict ourselves to saying that smaller is better, right? If we think of a torso being good, then for all subsets of it, we also want those subsets to be good. And ideally, what would we want to do? Well, we would want to have a decomposition so that, well, we don't know how the graph looks like, but if it had bounded tree widths, then our decomposition should have small bytes. Right? If the graph excludes a minor, then the decomposition should spit out the Robertson Seymour graph minor structure theorem. Right? If the graph excludes a topological minor, then all the torsos should be nearly embeddable or have almost bounded degree. Now the question is, and you can add an infinite list of properties here, right? And you basically want your tree decomposition to have all of those properties simultaneously, if possible. Now, this is a quite hopeless dream, right? It sounds incredibly powerful. And we won't be able to get all we want for many, many reasons. One of them, for example, is that tree width is NP-hard, right? So when I say efficiently compute, I cannot allow myself polynomial time. There's also existential questions on, like, what do we mean by better, which is what I'm going to go into. However, even though we cannot get all that we want, we can get quite close. You can get surprisingly close to what I just said. Now, in order to get this close, let's define what we mean for one tree decomposition to be better than another tree decomposition. And I'm going to warn you that this is an attempt at a definition that won't work, but then we'll fix it so that it will work. All right, so let's say that we have a tree decomposition TD, chi D. The underscore D signifies that this is the supposedly good tree decomposition that dominates or is better than some other tree decomposition, let's say T chi. What does that mean? Well, every bag of the supposedly good tree decomposition should appear as a subset of the bag of some bag of the supposedly bad tree decomposition. So if my decomposition is better than yours, then for every bag I have, you should have a bag that contains my bag, because smaller is better. Right? This is so for every bag of my decomposition, there is a bag in your decomposition such that my bag is a subset of yours. Okay, this is a super strong condition. Let's make it a little bit weaker so that we make the setting a little bit more realistic. Let's not demand that my bag is a proper subset of yours. Let's instead demand that there is at most a constant number of vertices in my bag that are not in your bag. And let that constant be P. I mean, think of P really as a constant, and that is what we will mean by P dominating. Okay, so my decomposition, P dominates yours if every bag in, for every bag in my decomposition, there is one in yours, so that there are at most P vertices of my bag that don't appear in your bag. All right, and now we ask the following question. Does there exist a tree decomposition which is the best tree decomposition? In particular, if I give you for every graph, is it possible for every graph G an integer K? Is it possible to give a best tree decomposition, TD, chi D, with adhesions that are not much bigger than K, so they should only depend on K, not the graph, such that TD, G of K dominates all tree decompositions with adhesions at most K? So if I give you a number, let's say 4, you should give me a number, let's say 1,000, so that for any graph, you can come up with a tree decomposition with adhesions of size 1,000 that are better than all tree decompositions of that graph with adhesions of size 4. Right? Then the question is, can we get this? And the answer is unfortunately no. Why no? Here is a bad example. Suppose that it's possible to, at 1,729, dominate all tree decompositions with adhesion of size 4. And suppose it's someone claims that it's possible to do this always for every graph with a tree decomposition with adhesions of size 42. Of course, 1729 and 42 are arbitrarily chosen numbers here. Right? So now let's give you a challenge, decompose this, namely the grid of dimension 10 to the 10 times 10 to the 10. Okay? So now the challenge is to find a best decomposition of this grid with adhesions of size 42. So suppose that someone claims they're able to do this, right? Well, the tree width of 10 to the 10 times 10 to the 10 grid is 10 to the 10. So we know that the supposed amazing tree decomposition that someone gave us has a bag of size at least 10 to the 10. Okay, let's stare at that bag. To show that their tree decomposition that supposedly dominates every tree decomposition with adhesion 4 actually doesn't do it, it is sufficient to get to obtain a bad one, a bad tree decomposition, that TD chi D doesn't dominate. In particular, we need to demonstrate that the bag B doesn't appear as a subset, or doesn't almost appear as a subset of any bag of this tree decomposition. So how do we do that? Well, B is a subset of vertices in the grid. And the grid, as we know it, is bipartite. Therefore, it contains an independent set of size at most, or at least, B over 2. Okay, let's pick out that independent set. Now we make this bad tree decomposition. It looks like a star. The center is just the entire vertex set of the graph. It's almost all of the vertices in the graph. But I remove the independent set. Therefore, this bag misses half of B, so it doesn't contain almost all of B. Right? It doesn't contain almost all of the bag B because you ripped out half of it. Right? And then we add up, for every vertex in the independent set, we add up a new bag that we attach to it with the neighborhood of each individual vertex of the independent set. And notice that all of these bags have size 4, so they definitely miss all of B. This is a tree decomposition of my graph. It's a tree decomposition of my graph with adhesions of size at most 4. Our claimed decomposition TD chi D couldn't have been a best decomposition. Right? This seems like a sort of strange spurious example, right? We're basically using the fact that the graph has constant degree to pull out some small vertices from our bags and thereby destroying this best property. And the question is somehow, is this the only badness that can occur? And essentially, it turns out that yes, that is the only badness that can occur. So let's make another attempt at defining what it means for one tree decomposition to be better than another. So what are we going to say? Well, in the attempt one, we said that my decomposition is better than yours if all vertex sets that appear together in some bag in my decomposition also appear together in some bag of yours. Now, let's change this sentence around and say that my decomposition is better than yours if all vertex sets that appear together in mine do not appear apart in yours. Right? Sounds like I'm saying the same thing, right? But if you formalize it, it becomes different enough that it actually fixes the problem. So to formalize what we mean by can't appear apart, we need a little bit more concepts about tree decompositions. So if I have a tree decomposition, t chi, and I pick up an edge of the decomposition tree, it is between two vertices, u and v, in the decomposition tree, and let me remove that edge. Right? Then the decomposition tree breaks up into two pieces. Let's call it tu and tv. And slightly abusing notation, I can use the function chi on each of the bags individually in the tree and take their union, right? So the left side is chi of tu, and the right side is chi of tv, right? This is how we will define, just applying, this is just notation for taking the union of all of the bags in the left tree and taking the union of all of the bags in the right. All right, so when is one tree decomposition better than another? Well, my tree decomposition, TD, chi D, is better than yours if, so we're now we define this P dominates right away for some constant P, if for every bag in my decomposition and every edge of your tree decomposition, my bag cannot have large intersection with both sides of that edge. Because that means that something, if you think of the algorithmic consequences of tree decompositions, where you are decomposing, you're trying to decompose the graph into small pieces or like more structured pieces, then basically what this says is that if I need to handle a group of vertices together, then you won't be able to split them up and handle a large part on one side and a large part on another. So if you stare at this definition, it says that for every bag of my tree decomposition and every edge of yours, either the intersection of this B1 should be BD, I'm sorry, either the intersection of my bag with the left-hand side of your decomposition or the intersection of my bag with the right-hand side of the decomposition should be at most constant. So let's look at the picture. Suppose I propose you a decomposition like this, and I want to compare it with a decomposition like that. Well, in order to do that, I need to pick up an edge, right? I need to compare every bag of my tree decomposition with every edge of yours. So pick up one pair, remove the edge, look at TU, TV, and look at the bag. And then, what is allowed, what is not allowed? Well, if I draw chi of tu, chi of tv, then my bag cannot appear spread out on both sides, but it can appear all on one side with a little bit sticking out. Right? So this is how the picture should look like for every edge of the decomposition and every bag of this one, and this is how it's not allowed to look like for anything. All right. So now let's ask the question again. Is there a best tree decomposition? Right? Does there exist for every graph G and integer K a tree decomposition with adhesions of size f of k so that ug of k dominate every other decomposition with that has adhesions of size at most k? And now the answer is yes. In fact, we proved last year the following statement, that for every graph G and integer k, there exists a tree decomposition with adhesions of size 2 to the k. I think it's like 16, 2 to the bigger, I think it's like 16 to the k. So that you 16 to the k dominate all tree decompositions with adhesions of size k. So let's compare. Right? So what does this mean? Right? The tree decomposition that our theorem outputs, let's draw it on the left-hand side, and let's compare it with any tree decomposition of adhesion size at most k. Well, it means that for every bag of our decomposition, let's look at every edge of the one we're comparing it to. Then for every edge, we know that most of that bag lives on one side, right, of that edge. So for every edge, we can put an arrow, which direction is the richest. And of course, these arrows all need to be consistent, right? They need to point towards the same center. Now, the question is, does this center actually have to contain the vast majority of this bag? No, right? It could actually contain nothing, for all we know. But what we know is that for each of the subtrees behind here, they only contain a little bit. So basically, we know that our bag lives here with a little bit of stuff sticking out on all sides, but it could be that actually the entire bag is in all of these outgrowths. And this was exactly the problem that was happening in the bad example, which is now captured. All right. Let's see how much time I have. Let's have a closer look at our decomposition theorem. So if our decomposition P dominates all other decompositions, in particular, it P dominates all decompositions where the decomposition tree only has two vertices. Right? These are the sort of silly ones. Well, what are the tree decompositions of the graph where the decomposition tree only has two vertices? Well, these are exactly the separations of G of order at most k. So what is a separation of order at most k? Well, a separation of a graph is simply a cover of the vertex set by two sets, A and B, so that there are no edges between their symmetric difference. All right? And you can verify that this is exactly the same as a tree decomposition of the graph with two nodes, right? With one bag is A, the other bag is B. The order of the separation corresponds to the width of that silly decomposition. This is the size of A intersection B. So now that we know that our tree decomposition needs to dominate all tree decompositions with the decomposition tree of size at most 2, well, let's see what this means for separations. Well, the bags need to be unbreakable in the following sense. So a vertex set is q, k unbreakable if for every separation of order at most k, the set lives almost entirely in one side of the separation. So there is either at most q vertices of that set on the left side or at most q vertices of that set on the right. So again, this is the picture. This is a no, while that is a yes. All right, now let's restate the decomposition theorem. Well, for every graph G and every integer k, there exists a tree decomposition with adhesions at most 2 to the big O of k. We haven't changed anything so far. So that all bags are 2 to the big O of k, comma k unbreakable in G. This is a direct consequence of having to dominate all tree decompositions with exactly two nodes. Of course, this is equivalent to the previous statement, because what we needed to do there was for every tree decomposition on every edge of that decomposition, see that you weren't spread around that edge. But for that edge, you're actually just checking it against a particular separation. Right? So this is the final statement of the decomposition theorem, that for every tree, for every graph G and every integer k, you can actually find the tree decomposition with adhesions of size something like 16 to the k, such that every bag is some 16 to the k, comma k unbreakable. So let's do one application before I round off, because here's an interesting thing. Is it possible to directly apply the fact that the torsos are unbreakable in order to get algorithms, right? If you don't know anything about your torsos, other than that they are unbreakable, can you use it algorithmically? And it turns out that you can. So here is a nice application. Let's consider the minimum bisection problem. What is that? I give you a graph G and an integer k, and I ask you, can I partition my vertex set into two exactly equal-sized pieces so that the number of edges between the left and the right is at most k? Of course, I can do this in time n m to the k, right? I can try the k edges that go from left to right, remove them, I get connected components, and then I get unary knapsack instance for checking who should go to the left and who should go to the right. But now the question, can you get an algorithm that has the same polynomial factor for every fixed value of k, right? Namely, whether bisection is fixed parameter tractable. Well, what's been done? Well, if you're removing vertices rather than edges, this is doubly hard. You can't expect an FPT algorithm. It's FPT on planar graphs, but it's not even known to be NP-complete on planar graphs. This is funny. So this is a really nice open problem. It's FPT if you know that after you remove the solution, the number of components is constant, not a function of k. And also, if you don't want to split the graph exactly in half, but you allow some wiggle room, right? Between like 49% and 51%, right? Or should balance. Then you can get FPT. Essentially, this is not quite true, but this is essentially what was shown by Uri and Madian. All right. So what we're going to see a sketch of is an algorithm that shows that bisection is in fact fixed parameter tractable, and that it can be solved in time 2 to the big O of k cubed time. So what our algorithm actually will solve is the slightly more general problem, where I tell you that I want exactly a vertices on the left and exactly n minus a vertices on the right. So we apply our decomposition with adhesions of to make the bags 16 to the k, comma k unbreakable. And so our adhesions are of size something like 16 to the k. So we get our decomposition. And then we ask, well, how does the parts a comma b live in this decomposition? Well, I know that there's only k edges going between left and right. So in particular, I know that my part a needs to, if I look at any bag, it's either almost entirely containing a vertices or almost entirely containing b vertices. Because if it contained a lot of a and a lot of b vertices, you could, the bag wouldn't be unbreakable, right? Because you could split the A part of the bag from the B part of the bag with at most k edges. So how can we use this? Well, I told you that the intuition is that if you can solve the problem on the torsos themselves, then you should be able to solve it for the general graph. So that's basically what we're going to do. Let's assume that all the torsos are actually just connected components. Okay? Then what do we need to do? Well, we need to solve the problem on each of these connected components individually, but then we have a unary knapsack instance, because basically we need to find exactly, well, how many vertices here should be put in A and how many should be put to B. It's almost all on one side, but I don't know exactly quite how many. And then I need to piece together all of these solutions in a knapsack kind of manner. So really what I need to solve, I need to stare at one unbreakable graph, and to solve the problem where I give you a prescribed number, and I want to have that many vertices on one side, that many vertices on the other, and ask, what is the minimum number of edges that realizes those constraints? All right, so we need to handle graphs where the entire vertex set is unbreakable, right? So I give you a 2, k unbreakable graph, integers k and a, and I ask you, is there a partition of the vertex set into two parts, such that the left side has a vertices, and there are k edges at most from A to B? Notice that we can assume without loss of generality that the A side is the small one, right? Because just by symmetry. So we're going to give a randomized algorithm that handles unbreakable graphs. What does it do? Well, it runs in polynomial time. This is truly polynomial, nothing weird here. It always says no on no instances. But on a yes instance, it will find an output, a solution, with really small probability, but it's at least 1 over 2 to the 2 to the k times 2 to the k. So the success probability is a function of k only. This is the important part. Now, if I repeat this algorithm 2 to the 2 to the k times, then I can boost my success probability to something constant. all right, so suppose I have an unbreakable graph, and here we have some unknown optimal solution, and it has a neighborhood of size at most k. Right? We know that. Well, what are we going to do? We're going to just apply a random coloring to the graph. We're going to color the vertices of the graph red and black uniformly at random. And chances are this random coloring isn't going to give us anything at all. But we could get really lucky, and we could get really lucky in the following sense, that all of A gets colored red, and all of the neighborhood of A gets colored black. Now notice that the size of A is at most 2 to the k, and the size of the neighborhood of A is at most k, so the probability of this happening is like 1 over 2 to the 2 to the k. Right? So the probability of getting lucky is a function of k only. Now the question is, suppose we have a good random coloring, how do we get back to the unknown optimal solution? Well, we know, if we have a good random coloring, that everything that's black should definitely go on the B side, whereas everything that's red, if I look at the connected components induced by the red, each connected component should either in its entirety go into A, or in its entirety go into B. So this is the picture I have. I have a bunch of stuff that definitely should go into B, and I have some connected components where each of them either entirely goes into A or entirely into B. Right? Now, every time I pick a component into A, that adds some number of vertices to A, and it adds some number of new cuptetrads. Right? So basically, to figure out whether I can satisfy the criteria, all I need to do is to solve yet another unary knapsack instance. Right? And then we're done. So of course, the question is this too simplified? Right? This is what we solve here, and this is what we claim that we can solve. But in order to fix that up, all you need to do is to do dynamic programming over the tree decomposition. The problem here becomes somewhat more technical, but the idea is exactly the same. All right, let's conclude. We can decompose any graph into unbreakable sets. We have one application of it right now. This cannot be the only application. So my feeling is that we have a giant hammer, and we're looking for nails. So some future work. Well, this is not quite a conjecture. I made a bold conjecture, I think, yesterday or 2 days ago, right? So this is not quite a conjecture, but a gut feeling, and that is that the parameters for unbreakability and for how much and the adhesion size shouldn't be 2 to the k, it should be poly k, especially given the excluded grid theorem that has been improved to polynomial. Recently, my feeling is that this should be the truth. And of course, solving this would be very nice. Thanks. I don't think so, because basically, if I remember correctly, and I might be wrong here, all of this was talking about constant tree width graphs, right? And in our sense, any two constant tree width decompositions of the same graph are incomparable, because of this noise parameter that just eats that up all together, right away.
Other questions? Do you think the same similar notion of best decomposition can be defined for random decomposition?
Yes, and I've been thinking on it without really getting anywhere just yet.
Let's thank the speaker once more.